Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the 8th video in the ESP32 series using Expressive IDE. We have already covered the UART, I2C, and SPI peripherals, so now we will see the ADC peripheral of the ESP32. We will cover the ADC peripheral in two videos. Today's video will cover the one-shot conversion mode, where each channel can be converted individually. And in the next video we will cover the continuous conversion mode. I am using the ESP Room 32 development board, which you can purchase from the Controllers Tech store. Here I am using the one with 38 pins. Let's see the pinout of this board. You can see there are a lot of pins that support the analog mode. Basically we have two ADCs, ADC1 and ADC2. Each ADC has a lot of channels, and each channel is assigned one pin. Here you can see ADC1 channel 0, 3, 6, 7, 4, 5 and 8. Then we have different channels of ADC2. There are a few more channels of ADC2 on the right side. I am going to use the two channels of ADC1, channel 0 and 3. The pins assigned to these channels are VP and VN. So I am going to connect the potentiometers to these two pins. You can use other channels as well. Just try to avoid the pins marked with red color. These are the strapping pins, and they are used during flashing the board. You can use them, but they require some additional configuration, which we will avoid at this time. There are other available pins, so better use them. Let's see the connection now. Here is how the potentiometers are connected to the board. Both the potentiometers are powered with 3.3 volts from the board itself. I have connected the output pins of the potentiometers to the ADC channel 0 and 3, pin VP and pin VN. Before we start writing the code, let's see the documentation available. Here I have the ESP32 docs for the latest stable version. Under the API reference, Peripheral API, you can see the ADC one-shot mode driver. Basically the ESP32 supports two different modes for the ADC. In one-shot mode, only one conversion is performed once. Whereas in the continuous mode, the ADC keeps on converting the desired number of channels continuously. In today's video, we will check the one-shot mode. Let's open the Expressive IDE and create a new project. We will create the project using the templates, so search for the ADC here. Here we have the examples for one-shot mode and continuous mode. Let's select the one-shot mode, rename the project, and select Finish. Alright, here we have our project which we will modify, but let's build the project first. We will write an entire code from scratch. So let's remove this pre-generated code. I am leaving the calibration related functions only. Let's remove this entire while loop also. This is again the calibration function, so leave this one. Remove this do initialization part though. Alright, let's write the code now. I am going to configure two channels, so the ADC raw array should have two elements, and so does the voltage array. Let's define an array of ADC channels that we will be using in this tutorial. I am using ADC channel 0 and channel 3. Now we will define the ADC one-shot handle, which will be used throughout the program. These calibration handles are defined inside the main function, so let's define them globally. The calibration handle is defined for each channel, so if you are using 6 channels, you need to define 6 handles here. Now we will define a new function to initialize the ADC. The parameters of this function will be the pointer to the ADC channels, and the number of channels we want to use. You can refer to the ESP32 ADC docs to initialize the ADC, they have provided examples to configure everything. We can also refer to the ADC OneShot header file, and configure everything provided in it. Here first of all we have the OneShot driver initial configuration. The first member of this structure is the ADC unit. ESP32 supports two ADCs, ADC1 and ADC2. We need to declare which unit we are using. The next member of the structure is the clock source. By default, the OneShot mode uses the RTC clock source, so if we leave the source clock to default, it will choose on its own. The next member is the ultra low power mode. By default, the ULP mode is disabled, so we will not configure this too. That means we only need to configure the ADC unit. Inside the ADC initialization function, we will define the OneShot initialization structure. Here we will just declare the unit ID as ADC1. The rest of the configuration is kept to default. After defining the configuration, call the function OneShot new init, and pass the configuration to this function. The second parameter of this function is the pointer to the ADC handle we define globally. Let's go back to the OneShot header file. The next structure is for configuring the channel. The first member of this structure is the ADC attenuation. The ADC attenuation is basically used to reduce the input voltage before being input to the ADC. The higher the attenuation, the more the voltage range we can measure. ESP32 supports a maximum attenuation of 12 decibels, which allows it to measure the voltage from 150 millivolts to 2450 millivolts. You can find more details about the attenuation in the ESP32 datasheet. Go to the ADC section under the analog peripherals. Here you can see the table showing how different attenuation configuration changes the measurable voltage range. We want to measure up to 3.3 volts, so we will use the attenuation value of 3. If you want to measure higher than 3.3 volts, you need to set up a voltage divider circuit, which allows only up to 3.3 volts to the ADC. We will discuss it in some other video. So we will configure the attenuation to 12 decibels. The next member of the structure is bit width. This is basically the resolution of the ADC channel. The higher the resolution, the more precise the result will be, but it also takes more time to convert a higher resolution channel. The table shows how the ADC values will vary for different resolutions. I am going to use the 12-bit resolution, so the ADC values will vary between 0 to 4095. If you set the bit width to default, the driver will automatically select the highest available resolution. Alright, we will now define the channel's configuration inside the initialization function. First, we will set the attenuation to 12 decibels, and then set the resolution to 12 bits. This is the channel configuration, and therefore we need to configure both channels with this configuration. I want to use the same configuration for both channels, therefore I am calling the channel configuration function inside the for loop. The first parameter of this function is the ADC OneShot handle, then we have the channel which we want to configure, and finally the pointer to the configuration itself. That is all we have in the OneShot header file. There are only two configurations needed to initialize the OneShot driver. We can use the OneShot read function to read the converted channel at any point in our program. Let's copy this calibration function inside the initialization function itself. We will first read the data without calibration, so that we can compare it with calibrated values later. Therefore, I have commented out the calibration functions. Alright, let's write the main function now. Here first call the initialization function to initialize the ADC. We have already defined the channels, and we want to convert two of them. Now inside the while loop, we will read the channels, convert them to voltage, and print the output on the console. The function ADC OneShot read is used to read the ADC channel. The parameters of this function are the ADC handle, the channel that we want to convert, and the pointer to the variable where the converted data will be stored. After retrieving the data from the channel, we will convert it to the voltage. For 12 bits resolution, a value of 4,095 corresponds to 3,300 millivolts. This is because we are powering the potentiometer with 3.3 volts, therefore it is the maximum voltage ADC can measure. So we will use the direct ratio to convert the ADC value to the voltage. Now we will print the raw value and the voltage value for each channel on the terminal. Both the channels will be converted and printed, and then we will give a delay of 500 milliseconds before the next conversion. Alright, that is all. Let's build and flash the project to the board. Let's open the terminal to see the data on the console. Here are the two potentiometers connected to the ESP32, just like I showed in the connection diagram. The rotary pot is connected to channel 0, and the multimeter is also connected to this pot. The sliding pot is connected to channel 3. Right now both the readings are 0. I am sliding the potentiometer now. You can see the channel 3 readings are increasing. Now the potentiometer is at the extreme end. The raw value is 4,095, and the voltage is 3,300 millivolts. Now I am bringing it back. The raw value is reducing, and so does the voltage. The pointer is near the middle now. The raw value is around 1,700, and the voltage is 1,400 millivolts. Let's leave it here, and now we will vary the rotary pot, which is connected to channel 0. Keep an eye on the multimeter as well. You can see both the raw value and the voltage are increasing. The voltage value printed at this point is around 900 millivolts, but the multimeter is showing 1.03 volts. So we have a difference of around 140 millivolts. Let's keep rotating the potentiometer. Now the voltage value printed is around 1700 millivolts, but the multimeter is showing around 1.85 volts. Again, we have a difference of around 140 millivolts between these values. Let's keep going with the potentiometer. The printed voltage is around 2700 millivolts, whereas the multimeter is showing around 2.8 volts. Now the potentiometer is at maximum. The voltage values are also at maximum. So we can measure the voltage using the ADC, which is approximately the same as measured with the voltmeter. Now we will use the calibration function to calibrate the ADC, and see if the data is more accurate. This function was part of the template itself. Basically, there are two calibration schemes in ESP32. Some of the boards support curve-fitting calibration scheme, while the others support line-fitting scheme. You can get more details about the calibration in the ESP32 docs itself. I am skipping this part, and we will go to the code directly. After initializing the channels, we need to calibrate them. So let's include the calibration functions here in the ADC initialization. The unit ID is ADC1. We will pass the first channel of the array here. The attenuation is 12 decibels, and the handle is already defined. Similarly, we will calibrate the second channel of the array. So we are calibrating both the channels in the initialization function itself. Inside the while loop, we will first read the channel 0 of the ADC. After reading the raw value, we will call the calibrated raw to voltage function, to convert the raw data to voltage. We need to pass the raw value, and the address of the voltage variable to its parameters. Similarly, we will read the channel 3, and convert the raw value to the voltage. Now we will print both the channels' data on the console. That is all, let's build and flash the project to the board. Here you can see the output saying the calibration scheme is line fitting, and the calibration was successful. It was printed again for the second channel. It's basically these logs getting printed on the console. Now we will see the voltage output here, and on the voltmeter also. Alright, let's rotate the potentiometer connected to channel 0. The voltage value printed is around 2250 millivolts, and the voltmeter also shows voltage around 2.2 volts. I am rotating it in the other direction now. The printed value is around 1590 millivolts, whereas the voltmeter shows around 1.56 volts. I am reducing it further. The printed voltage is around 555 millivolts, whereas the voltmeter is around 0.54 volts. We have an error of around only 30 millivolts after calibration, which was around 130 millivolts before calibration. This much error is acceptable as ADC values also fluctuate a lot. You can read multiple ADC values and then take the average to reduce the error further. The second potentiometer is also responding fine. So we were able to read multiple channels of the ADC using the one-shot mode. We also saw how calibration helps reduce the ADC error. This is it for the video. We will cover the continuous ADC reading in the next video. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.